feminism that I believe will be more humane for all of us. And I'm focusing on women because I believe that the changes that women have, that have come about because of the way women have behaved, have been extremely significant, and we need to redefine those and redirect those. So I want you to point out, I want you to return, you guys, to the very first lecture that I gave. And I mentioned to you that marriage integrates three things. It integrates our sexual activity, our child rearing, and our love of our spouses. And I describe marriage as kind of an integrating thing. And Cassie refers to sexual integrity. And this is how I see sexual integrity developing over the course of the lifetime, is all these things are integrated with one another. And so what I want to do at the beginning here is to create a hypothetical composite person, a picture of a person for whom sex, children, and childbearing are all separated and are all put off in different categories. And now the social practices that really illustrates what this is going to look like, and this radical kind of separation and breakdown, of course, is cohabitation. And I'm talking really about serial cohabitation. There's now a new term for this phenomenon. It's not enough anymore to talk about out-of-wedlock childbearing. We now have a new demographic phenomenon, which the demographers are calling multi-partner fertility. Multi-partner fertility. Why are we calling it multi-partner fertility? Because that captures the big picture of what's going on here. It's not just that somebody's having a baby out of wedlock and then nothing else happens. There's a whole series of things that take place. And so rather than regale you with a whole list of statistics, which we've had a lot of statistics, and of course you know that statistics make my heart beat fast because I am a nerd, you know, I'm going to tell you a story about a young lady that I'm going to call Lucy. Now, the things I'm about to tell you don't all happen to every single person, as Brad mentioned, but this will give you an idea of what the statistics show and hopefully put a human face on what some of these numbers are. Lucy's graduated from high school. She's got a job as a dental assistant. She lives with her boyfriend, Izzy. Now, Lucy gets pregnant. Now, it's not entirely clear whether this is an accidental pregnancy or not. She's been on the pill, but she's missed one or two. And parenthetically, I'm going to parenthetically give you a few statistics. Parenthetically, the failure rate for the pill for low-income cohabiting women under the age of 20 is 48%. The failure rate for the pill for low-income cohabiting teenagers is 48%. So Lizzie's kind of glad to be pregnant. She's always wanted to be a mother. Now Izzy, on the other hand, put your hand down. Izzy, on the other hand, is not happy. He's not ready to be a father. That was not part of his plan. He feels cheated. And truthfully, Lucy isn't completely clear in her own mind whether this was an accident or not, whether she missed the pills on purpose or whether she really and truly forgot. So they quarrel frequently. He sometimes hits her. Domestic violence is more common in cohabiting couples than it is in married couples, by the way. As her pregnancy proceeds, of course, she becomes less and less interested in sex, and Izzy becomes less and less interested in her. He has sex with a former girlfriend. Parenthetically, cohabiting couples are more likely to have secondary sex partners. He feels entitled, since he isn't getting any from Lucy, and after all, she cheated him by becoming pregnant in the first place. They quarrel some more. He moves out for a while, but he starts to feel something for the baby, and he gives up the girlfriend, and he moves back in. By the time baby Anna is born, he's moved back in with Lucy. But Lucy isn't so happy anymore. In fact, she becomes depressed. And it turns out that the presence of children increases a cohabiting woman's probability of depression. But children do not increase the probability of depression for married mothers. Izzy's caught up in the excitement for a while, but the combination, of course, of sleep deprivation and a needy baby and a preoccupied and depressed Lucy are more than Izzy can handle. He moves out for good when Anna is 6 months old. Cohabiting relationships are less stable than married relationships, as Brad mentioned. He never offers to contribute any support to the care of Anna, and of course, on average, never married fathers are much less likely to pay any child support than our fathers who were once married to their child's mother. Now Lucy finds she can't handle the demands of her job and the care of her baby by herself, so she goes to court, tries to get Izzy to pay child support. The court orders him to pay an amount that, of course, is nowhere near enough to support Anna and her care, but he doesn't have a very good job, and so she seldom collects even the amount that the court has ordered. And by the way, cohabiting men have half the income that married men have on average. So Lucy moves down.